I'm Amy, sex educator, sex and relationship coach, and co-owner of purepleasureshop.com.
I'm April, VP of the cutting-edge sex toy company Hot Octopus, and I dedicate my life to the business of sex.
We are on a mission to teach you how to have hot sex, deep intimacy, and how to make your own rules for who you are as a sexual being.
Welcome to the Shameless Sex Revolution.
Want to learn more? Go to shamelesssex.com.
And for 15% off of some of our favorite sex toys, use code SHAMELESSSEX at purepleasureshop.com.
You are listening to a pleasure podcast. For more from our sex podcast collective, visit pleasurepodcasts.com.
Well, hello, everyone.
Hi, everybody.
This episode, by the way, is with a repeat guest, Dr. Alison Ash. Oh, my gosh, I can't talk today. Dr. Alison Ash has been on our show 3 times. So this is her 4th time on our show. And this time she's talking about fantasies, all about fantasies, normalizing fantasies, how to bring more fantasies into your life, maybe for yourself or into partner play. So anyways, Dr. Alison Ash, amazing, amazing, amazing guest. And I want to do a little trigger warning for you all because we talk about fantasies here and some of them might be triggering to you because they might involve some conversations around maybe, say, incest or some other things. So if you feel like you are in a delicate place and that those conversations might be triggering, maybe wait to listen to this episode or be prepared to take care of yourself if something challenging happens, maybe some deep breaths, etc. But we just wanted to put that out there. It's totally normal and okay to feel triggered by these conversations, but we don't want you to feel blindsided when it happens. So, but really interesting conversation. I love her. She's amazing, amazing educator and speaker.
This is why she's been on the show so many times. She has a lot of incredible offerings and tools and advice and wisdom, and she's just a wonderful guest.
Yeah, and her episode, How to Eat Pussy Like a Champ, is still our number one episode.
Yeah, it's a good one.
And we recorded that like 3 years ago. Still number one.
When we could be in person.
And she teaches that class and a lot of other courses. She'll talk about this later in the episode, but she has a lot of wonderful online offerings that you can dive into right now should you want to learn more. So with that, Chip Chop, I think you have something you want to read us.
I want to read a testimonial titled, You Changed My Life. From a 24-year-old and a vulva owner who identifies as female, I grew up in a very conservative church and was even given a purity ring, in quotation marks, on my 13th birthday. For a long time, I pledged myself to wait until I was married to have sex, but this was a decision made only out of shame. When I came across your podcast, all I could think was shameless sex? That's what I want to be having. After binging your podcast.
Binging. But
oh. I was like, what? Binging.
Oops. It actually is. It is binging.
Binging is.
Binging.
I was like, is binging a new thing that
oh
I need
my
to learn
God,
about?
What is binging?
I don't know.
I want to try that.
After binging your podcast and with the help of a therapist, I have a much healthier relationship with sex and I have begun a masturbation practice. Thank you so much for offering sex education and shining light on a part of me that I was told needed to be hidden away from my whole life. Getting in touch with my sexuality has made me feel so much more confident and changed me for the better.
Yay! We love hearing that purity ring, huh?
Wow. And binging. Wow.
And binging. Did you bing with that purity ring? Is that what happens when you get a purity ring? Is you go bing?
Oh, I don't know. What is a purity
it's
ring?
It's that one where you're like promising to stay pure until marriage, and they do it for young people such as 13-year-olds. It's like a whole, I think there's like a whole ceremony around it or something like that. I can't say I know a lot about it.
It's like the conservative church way of having a bat mitzvah.
Yeah. Yeah, but save yourself because otherwise you're a sinner.
Yeah.
A dirty sinner. And this person, this
24-year-old vulva
owner who identifies as female, this woman, said that she didn't feel in alignment with her and she would only make that decision out of shame. And look at her now. She's baiting over there. She's discovering her body and her pleasure and feels fucking amazing. So
yeah,
thank you.
She's having shameless sex.
Oh yeah, you see, look, you're doing it. You're doing it, and that's exactly why we do what we do. So, thank you, listener. Testimonials like this are what really keeps us alive and vibrating over here. Not with sex toys. Well, we vibrate over here with sex toys too.
Yes, we do.
We do that on our own. Yeah, so keep writing these wonderful things. And for listeners out there who have not done so, you can go to iTunes and write a review just like this. This was actually in our email. But for this listener and anyone else who wants to help us out, go on to iTunes, give us 5 stars and write a review such as this. And guess what? It makes us more accessible to the entire world. We are global. We're all over the fucking world.
We're everywhere. And we're free.
And we're free too.
Hey. And we're free because of folks like OMGS.
Yeah,
OMGS. Which is another way to improve your sexuality.
Totally. It's an amazing way to improve your sexuality. So OMGS, we absolutely love OMGS and we have for years. OMGS.com/shameless. That's where you go check it out. You get 10% off. And what it is an online forum database program, etc., where it has these different seasons. Season one is all about external vulva pleasure and techniques and how you can enhance your orgasm or have orgasm or more pleasure. Season two is all about internal stimulation and pleasure for vulvas. And it's for folks who want to learn more techniques. Maybe you're already having amazing orgasms. You want to have bigger, better orgasms. Or maybe you've never had an orgasm. Or maybe you're a vulva admirer and you want to learn how to pleasure.
Well, yeah, OMGS is for everyone. So whether you're a penis owner, a vulva owner, you're a couple, you're not in a couple, you're single, you're whatever you're into, they have it's studies of 20,000 women ages 18 to 95, and they're going to come out with season 3 soon. So
ooh, sex toys, right?
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah. Go check it out. OMGS.com/shameless, and you get 10% off, and it just might change your life, just like it has for thousands of other people.
I think it's time for a sex question.
Let's do it. You don't know what this one is yet, or have you read it?
No, I didn't read it yet.
Surprise! Oh, okay, that's surprise in French if you didn't know. I'm bilingual. Okay, so I have been with my boyfriend for 7 months and he has a female best friend who is bi and is also in a relationship. I have been okay with their relationship as I don't believe the sex of the person makes a difference in friendship. And I get along with her too. But I recently found out that they slept together once about 4 years ago. Even though it was when they were drunk and they immediately regretted it, I now feel jealous when he spends time with her. Do you have any advice on how to deal with this, please? Ooh, jealousy.
Okay, so to recap.
So this person has their boyfriend has a friend, another woman who is bi and is in a relationship. And this person has been fine with their boyfriend being friends with this other person until they found out they slept together way before their relationship.
Okay.
And now they feel jealousy. Now knowing that there's a sexual history, there's some jealousy and insecurity there. So they said that they immediately regretted it. Now they're just friends. And so they're stating, we don't have attraction to each other. It was a one-time thing. We are just friends. But now because their genitals touched, it's changed things. Which I want to normalize this listener's experience. A lot of people have felt this before. Oh, now that you've had sex, or you had sex in the past, or this is an ex or whatever, because sex has happened, now I'm insecure or jealous. But when sex hasn't happened, I'm not. Which I think if we take a macro view on that and you look at it kind of from an outside perspective, just because genitals touch, that changes things. Interesting, because what if people just like they were attracted and they flirted, you know, 4 years ago and they almost had sex, but they didn't. Would that make a difference? Or, you know, is it just the genitals touching? And I think we just kind of get a little fixated on that being something really monumental and meaning something when it sounds like they're saying it didn't mean anything actually. But unless you don't trust them, my question is, do you trust your partner? Do you trust your partner's friend? And if you do, then this is probably your more internal work to do to kind of surrender to that trust. And what might help you if you haven't done this is to just speak to your insecurities. And you're not telling them to do anything different. You can't be friends. I'm not cool with this because that's controlling. But you can say, hey, you know, God, this is hard for me. But for some reason, now that I know that you had sex, I'm feeling this like insecurity. And I know that it's, you know, I trust you and I believe you when you say that you immediately regretted it and you're just friends. And yet I still feel this thing. I just want to share that with you to out it, to maybe take away some of the pressure. Or here's a request. You know, when you guys hang out, maybe you can give me some more words of affirmation, or maybe the three of us could spend more time together, or she and I can spend more time together, something to maybe just heal that a little bit. I don't know. What do you think, Chip?
I think that's valid. That's really good advice. And the thing about this, timing-wise, they've been together for 7 months, and it sounds like they slept together once 4 years ago, and there was alcohol involved, and there's regret. So I'm thinking, obviously, 4 years is quite a long time. They remain friends. They probably had a discussion about it and were like, that would never work. We don't want to destroy our friendship, or we want to just keep it as friends. So the jealousy is completely normal, because you'd be like, oh my God, why? What if they rekindle? Or you just, your brain starts telling you stories. And so I would say it sounds like that it's well in the past, and a conversation would be helpful just for security purposes. Although nothing can ever be 100% secure. So you just have to sort of trust, as you were saying, and build that trust. And 7 months is a new relationship. So that can take time. And you found out about this. So I'm hoping you found out by there was honesty, or from your boyfriend, or if you found out accidentally somehow.
Yeah, like, how did you find out?
Right. Was it like a, surprise?
Which that might take away some trust, right? They've been friends for 7 months, you've known about this and you just found out. So that might be like, whoa, now do I trust you? Why did you take so long to tell me? And maybe it's because they were afraid that this exact thing would happen. But we do find, honestly, when we hold in information like that, it usually bites us or kicks us in the ass later. We're like, fuck, I should have said that before.
Right. Well, we live in Santa Cruz and
everyone knows everyone slept with everyone.
Yes. So I've had to come to realizations about living in a small town and just understanding that there's 1 or 2 degrees of separation between everyone, including probably like me and your grandpa.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Well, he's not alive anymore.
I know. I know.
I live on a property that my ex-boyfriend owns. He was my first love. We were together from age 18 to 22. He owns a property. He lives in the main house. I've lived with him during other relationships as friends. And my partners, I can't say all of them, but some of them were uncomfortable with it. Like, this is so weird. This is not normal. And then some of them just saw what we really were. We're like brother and sister now. It's very different. And
it took time.
And partners, they trust me, and they trust him as their friend too. There were conversations were had. You know, it wasn't just this light thing. Oh yeah, we slept together once, or we dated once, but it's cool. You're fine, right? You know, so maybe just a little more diving into that. But yes, you are normal. And
it's a good question. Yeah. It's good advice.
I think a lot of people can relate at least at some point in their lives.
Well, you're bound to, unless you're in some very monogamous relationship for many, many, many years. And even then, nothing is forever.
And I think the people that we once were intimate with or in a relationship with, as long as it ended in a way that was, you know, loving or something, they can be important people in our lives. It doesn't mean that relationship has to be over. So I think it's special when we can hold on to those things. Maybe you need a little break in between, especially if there's still feelings and things. But at any rate, that's not what you're asking, so I won't talk too much about that. But yes, good luck to you, and thank you for writing in. And we love you, listener.
Are you ready for a bio?
Yeah, give me a bio.
Dr. Alison Ash is a sex and intimacy coach and educator, lecturer at Stanford University, author, and founder of TurnON.love. As a sociologist with a PhD from Stanford, Ali has a comprehensive understanding of complex societal challenges that often lead to unsatisfying and disempowering sexual experiences. Ali designs workshops, courses, and retreats, and offers individuals and couples coaching to give others the tools to discover their desires and confidently pursue them. She invites you to turn on pleasure, intimacy, and love at turnon.love. But first,
while it might be getting cold outside, you can continue to keep the bedroom nice and hot with Dipsy. If you're looking to heat things up, there's a story waiting just for you. Dipsy is an app full of sexy audio stories, and now they even have brand new written stories to arouse your senses. No matter who you're into or what turns you on, Dipsy helps you tap into your eroticism anytime, anywhere. I recently listened to Leather and Lace, featuring a wild threesome hookup, right before my partner came over, and I was so turned on, I couldn't keep my hands off of him.
There are hundreds of stories to choose from, and they release new content every week, so there's always something more to explore. Dipsy also offers wellness sessions to help you wind down, as well as sleep sessions to help you drift off. For listeners of the show, Dipsy is offering an extended 30-day free trial when you go to dipsystories.com/shameless. That's 30 days of full access for free when you go to dipseastories.com/shameless. dipseastories.com/shameless. Go check it out. All right, it's interview time.
All right, everyone, guess what time it is? It is interview time, and we are here with return guest Dr. Alison Ash. And this is Alison's fourth time on our show, and to this day, our number one episode is How to Eat Pussy Like a Champ, which was by
Dr. Alison Ash, and we recorded that, what, 3 years ago?
Maybe, yeah.
And it still is number one. Like, nothing will top that, although I heard you might have something about how to do the same thing with a dick coming out someday soon. So just stay tuned, everyone, because that will be here at some point. But today we are here with Dr. Alison Ash. We love her, and we're so happy to have her back, and we're here to talk about fantasies. And even though you all heard the intro and heard a little bit about Alison in the bio, Dr. Alison Ash, by the way, we will start with the same prompt as we always do. Can you please tell us how you got to where you are today in the field of sexuality?
Sure, yeah. Well, I grew up in a family where there wasn't much intimacy modeled for me, or I think like most folks, it wasn't taught well in my family structure or in my school system. And so I think, like many of us, I bumbled around and made countless mistakes and felt like a failure and felt really alone and or unsatisfied sexually or unable to make relationships work. And I think it just required a whole lot of self-growth work and commitment to learning some of the skills that I didn't learn as a kid. And then I think one of the things that's so powerful about going through that journey is, you know, I think when you see the water that everybody's swimming in, that folks who are raised with some of these intimacy skills just don't see because it's so innate for them. I think when you have to learn it piece by piece, you get really good at explaining it to other people in a way that really de-shamifies the process, because you can normalize it because you've been there. And so I think for me, getting to do this work is about offering other people the insights from my own personal experiences and, of course, from all the trainings that I've done, so that they can have the kinds of sexual interactions and romantic relationships that they want, because I know how much it hurts to not be able to have them or to sustain them.
Mm. Yeah, I've taken a lot away from every one of the podcasts we've recorded with you. I still use some of the techniques you've taught. Ooh. With the bedroom, the tap technique, instead of if you're not good at speaking to what you want in the bedroom, you can use the three touch. Taps oh. means this, or, and I still use that. And I've actually told other folks out there, friends that have asked me about those techniques. And this is why I'm excited to talk to you about fantasies, because... Ooh. We've talked a little bit about it on the show before, and not in this way. So let's talk about fantasies with you, Dr. Alison. And we all have them. I don't want to say a stereotypical, like, oh, we all have fantasies. From time to time, though, everyone does, whether it's maybe an imaginary friend fantasy where you're like, this is my imaginary friend.
Like, not
friend.
Sexual, just like, yeah, okay. Yeah.
But you also have sexual fantasies, which
like
is...
Like, sometimes I have sex with my imaginary friend.
Maybe. That was Amy being an only child, eating cat food and having her sex with her imaginary friend. Anyway, my question.
That's probably true.
No shame in that. So, okay, my question here, though, is what do you think are the benefits of embracing fantasies?
Yeah, well, and I guess I'll just say that there are some people out there that feel like it's very hard to have sexual fantasies. And what I like to tell them is, have you ever thought what you would do with $1 million? Or what your ideal date would be, or your favorite vacation? And to help you realize that, as you said, you can fantasize in other arenas, and that can make it feel a little bit more accessible sexually. And I think that there are so many reasons why it can be beneficial to fantasize. It's a wonderful place to start to explore your desires with utter permission. I really like to emphasize the mental liberation component of fantasizing, how important it is to realize that nothing is bad or wrong once it's in your mind, like, and it stays in your mind, that you have the right to think about whatever you want to think, and that you can have fantasies that you never want to have happen in real life, and fantasies you never want to share with anybody, and that's totally okay. We'll talk about how to share them if and when you want to, but just to realize that there is this space in your mind that you can go to explore and try on things without having to worry about anybody else's reaction or whether or not it's ethically or morally okay, because you're not harming anybody because it's just in your mind.
Mm. I love that. I love that permission giving, the normalizing. And so I'm going to talk about myself for a minute, the only child. So I remember being 10-ish, watching Melrose Place, I think, is what inspired
this. You've talked about this before.
Yeah. And I saw a rape scene. And I had never been raped. I had never experienced any form of molestation or non-consensual act of sexual violence. Later on in life, I did experience like a lot of compliance sex and various things that are a little funky. But at that point, I had not. And I saw this scene. I'm like 10, really turned on by it. And I remember actually, we had this big backyard at my house, and I would walk around in circles in the yard. And I know that sounds crazy, but you know, I was just telling stories in my head though about, and it was about rape fantasies, you know, and I didn't, you know, fully, and it wasn't like, you know, this idea of like, I really want this to happen. We'll talk about that later, about the difference between like you said that, but you know, like role play versus fantasies and like, I want this to happen, or is this just for my mind? But you know, that, and I didn't shame myself then. I was like, this is really hot. And then later I remember some partners being like, what the fuck? That's some crazy shit. You want to be raped? Like, no, this is my fantasy. Anyways, so, which brings me to my question. What are some of the most common fantasies that you hear of that people fantasize about?
Yeah. So, Justin LaMiller came out with some research that talked about 7 different categories of fantasies that I think is really helpful to reference, because it's so normalizing when you can see how many and there have been research out there that has been done that shows that just the really wide breadth of types of fantasies. And so even these 7 categories, I don't want that to feel limiting, but common categories are multi-partner sex, a power control, rough sex. So that could be any kind of BDSM, novelty, adventure, variety. We always like a sense of newness or feeling like we have that sense of excitement. Non-monogamy, getting to explore extramaritally, taboo and forbidden sex. So maybe like places you shouldn't be having it or ways that you shouldn't be doing it. Passion and romance, like this is just a very general and wonderful like category of fantasies I think people often overlook when they're going to more of the hardcore stuff. And then this category that I think is really interesting called erotic flexibility. And this might mean exploring sex with folks of different genders or sexual orientations that you might be used to, or maybe exploring your own gender identity and expression. And so, again, you can see how fantasies are a wonderful place for you to try on some of these things with some sense of safety and permission.
So there's so, and then within those categories, it's like infinite, right? Like that's all right. The things that could possibly be in there. So what would you put the rape fantasy ones? That was more like the rough sex power,
power and control
dynamic
or taboo
thing.
Even.
Yeah.
Right.
Taboo as well.
Yeah.
That's
taboo.
Right.
Tell me one of your fantasies, Chip.
So I was just thinking about this. I used to do this taxi cab porn thing for a long time where I was watching taxi cab. And I will say I have this power play dynamic thing that's been really consistent throughout my life, where it's positions of power that get me off. But
are you in power though?
No, I am not in power.
You're the submissive one.
I'm the submissive one. So it's sort of the boss and the employee, or the teacher and the student. Ooh. Or most recently, which this, you know, this could be triggering for some people, but this is a fantasy and this is shameless sex. So the step fantasy, where it's like the stepmom with this, with the step hope, this 18-year-old step person, stepchild, usually a penis owner. And so, yeah, that's it. So, and now the show is over, everyone. So now, you know,
no, it's good. But I love hearing the variety of it. Yeah.
I have a little bit of, it's like, gives me a little anxiety when I actually speak to it out loud, but it's something that I would never ever do in my life. But I had a lot of, I want to say, traumatic experiences with step parents in my life, and I think that it's a way for me to almost take the power back by having these fantasies now.
Ooh.
So that's how I look at it, and that's why I allow myself to.
That's a good question, though. What do you think about that as being a way where people take power back?
Yeah, I think that a lot of fantasies are about resolving challenging emotions or challenging situations that we can't always navigate in real life in the way that we might want. And so these could be challenging situations that we're navigating currently, or oftentimes challenging situations from being a kid. For example, if you had a very competitive relationship with your sibling where you felt like you could never compete and you were never enough and you were never chosen, it might be that you have fantasies around being very desired and sought after and people waiting in line to be able to pleasure you. And, you know, like you could see where that would be a very hot kind of fantasy. I think that for folks folks who have a hard time experiencing pleasure or exploring orgasm or those kinds of things. Things like orgasm denial or forced pleasure could be really hot. I think a lot of BDSM, a lot of fantasies in general, is about how can I reconstruct something that was maybe out of my control in a way where it's now in my control, where I can change it and direct it and stop it when I want to stop it. That's that part of that safety piece of being able to explore something where you don't have to worry about somebody else taking over.
I like this. And this is, I maybe am more advanced than I thought in the world of fantasy at this part. But so what about the people who fantasize about someone other than their partner? And I am guilty of this. And I don't want to see, there's
not
no guilt.
Guilty.
There's no guilt in that. It's just, I'm saying I am a participant in feeling, sometimes I feel bad. I feel guilt. I mean, that's me. It's my own experience when I'm like, oh, I'm not fantasizing about my partner. So the question here is advice for these folks, such as myself or other people out there that aren't fantasizing about the someone that they're partnered with or partners that they have. And if they're doing this while having sex with them, is this something that they should take a look at, or is this something that's okay? Can you kind of just open up and let us know more insight to this?
Is April guilty?
Am I guilty as charged?
Well, first of all, I do want to normalize this because it is pretty common. And what I can say is that I don't want to assign a value judgment of right or wrong. What I do want to name is that if you're looking to feel intimacy and connection with your partner, and if fantasizing about other people is getting in the way of that, maybe because you feel guilty or maybe because you feel not present with them, then I would think about maybe trying one of two tactics. On one hand, you could let yourself fantasize about that hot pool boy and then come back to your partner. And you're kind of just like swinging between the two. So letting yourself fantasize for a little bit and then noticing your partner's skin and body and responsiveness and how they're touching you and the way that they're sounding and really coming back to the present moment and then letting yourself fantasize a little bit more. So that's one idea. The second, and this is only probably applicable to some relationships where there's this kind of openness and we could talk about maybe how to get there. But one thing that you could do is share this with your partner and bring them in on it. So maybe that might mean like both of you talking about how hot it is, or maybe it's you now constructing a threesome fantasy where your partner is involved, or, and that could be something that you share with them or just something that you're doing in your own mind. And this could be in a way that just is either feeling good in integrity with your own self so that you can kind of quiet some of that guilt, or it could be done in a way where you could share it with them so that it's a new form of intimacy and bonding that you could have with each other.
I love all these options. And I think that they're, I've talked to a lot of folks that have shame about that. Like, there's something wrong with me, especially with the whole idea that like we should all be monogamous forever and never have desire for anyone else and that whole bullshit. And as I say that, I'm not going to say that everyone should be non-monogamous. But I think what Dr. Alison Ash is saying is what's in our minds is ours and it doesn't make anything wrong with us. And we can fantasize about whatever we want. And what I'm hearing you say is that if it creates a disconnect, then maybe that's something to work with. But if it's helping you to connect and have great sex and get off, then like, fucking have a great time with that. So what about for folks though? Because I've seen this for some folks where if you ask them, I've worked with clients before too. Oh, and by the way, as I say this, I have friends that have worked with you, by the way, and they speak so highly of you. So as I speak about myself working with people, I have multiple friends that work with you or have in the past, and you've changed their lives.
I want to say every time that she's on a show with us, I overshare information that I normally wouldn't. I'm like, I just want to tell you things.
Yeah.
I do. I'm like, oh, and then?
So the folks, though, who say, like a partner's like, hey, what are your fantasies? And they're like, I don't really know. Or I don't really have fantasies, or I don't know, like maybe it's just sex in a shower and that's about it. And they're like, well, that's it. Like, what else? What are your tips for those folks and how they can maybe tap more into their own fantasy game? Not just to please a partner, not just like, oh, my partner wants me to have fantasies, so I'm going to create them, but how they can, maybe there's like a block or something and how they can tap deeper into that part of themselves.
Sure. Yeah. I think that one thing that's important is drawing some inspiration. we all reference material from either our own personal experiences or different forms of erotica that we've been exposed to help us fantasize. And so I think that consuming erotica, particularly non-visual forms of erotica, so that might be audio porn, that could be erotica being read out loud, sounds of people having sex or masturbating, it could be reading erotic short stories. If you want to send me a message through my website at TurnON.love, I have a list of erotica resources that I have collected that I think are really wonderful, that are queer or feminist or are BDSM, all sorts of different genres, but that are non-visual. And I think that this is really helpful because when it's non-visual, your brain starts to fill in the gaps. It's already starting to participate in the erotica that you are consuming. And then what I would suggest that you do is that you start to know what are the things that turn you on, what are the themes that really do it for you, as well as what turns you off. And so I really recommend separating your erotica exploration sessions from your I just want to get off sessions. Because when you're exploring erotica, you're going to find a lot of things you don't like. And that's actually useful information, but it might not help you get off, right? And so separating the two can be helpful. And then always, I suggest, I'm a little bit of a data nerd and very organized, but I always like to save the links or the authors or the locations of the erotica that I like, so that when I do want to just get off, I can go straight to a favorite. But also because when you find something that was well produced, always go down the rabbit hole of what else have they created or who else have they collaborated with. And that's a wonderful way of making your way through the immense amount of erotica that is out there to start to just get your creative juices going a little bit more. The other thing that I'll just say real quick is I think creating that sense of safety with your partner is also really important. And so that might look like creating permission to talk about things and not having to do them in real life. It can look like talking about things and promising not to yuck each other's yums, meaning not to shame what the other person is into, even if you're not into it yourself.
Love that term.
And also going slowly, like thinking about scaffolding. So if I have my most intense fantasy, maybe I'm not going to share that one right away. Maybe I might share something like a shower scene that might be a little bit more tame and the other person might think is a little bit, you know, pathetic or not juicy enough, but that's a stepping stone into sharing something else. And so celebrating and always kind of honoring the vulnerability of sharing something is a helpful way of then encouraging something that might be a little edgier.
So doing kind of setting the scene for someone that's maybe less apt in sharing their fantasies with a lover or a partner. Let's speak to someone that maybe there's more shy or they have shame in their fantasies. What do you, because you've already listed some wonderful ways to drop in and help your partner understand your fantasies. For those folks though, that maybe struggle, because you do have great techniques with other things we've talked about, the tapping effect. Is there anything that people could do? Maybe just a couple of better ways to share with lovers some fantasies, even if there's maybe fantasies that you're terrified they're going to reject or shame you for.
Yes. Well, the first thing that I would suggest is to think about how the fantasy makes you feel, because there's always an emotional element to fantasies. Right? Maybe your fantasy has you feel really desired, or maybe it has you feel a little naughty or precious or used or worshipped or ravished or devoured, or like you don't have to worry about anything or totally competent or whatever it is, right? There could be a huge laundry list of ways that your fantasy helps you feel. And I think that if you start with the emotion, it's much easier to have empathy come online, which creates safety, creates a sense of acceptance and belonging. And then the reality is that if you know, okay, I want to feel, let's go with a rape fantasy. I want to feel like you want me so badly, you can't hold back. And I want to feel like that I don't have to feel guilty or bad for having naughty sex with you because it's not my fault. Okay, so those are the emotions that are at the core of the fantasy. So even if I don't want to share a rape fantasy with you because I'm really worried that you're going to be judgy or put off or whatever else it might be, I can say, okay, I have some fantasies, and I think the way that I really want to feel my fantasy is like this. And then just see how they respond and see if you can get a sense of like, okay, like they're into that, that's hot. Well, maybe then you two could talk about what are some ways that you could create that feeling together. So you're already starting to fantasize jointly rather than you having to share something that feels really vulnerable and personal. And then as you two start talking about fantasies together and you're getting a sense of the ways in which they're open and welcoming and maybe contributing and having their own things that they think are hot, it can actually then make it feel easier to start to share some of your edgier fantasies. And I think that it's completely okay to set the scene around what you want to feel safe to share. So reminding them that there's no obligation, but also asking them how you want them to respond. It would feel so good to me if you could tell me that you think it's hot, that I think it's hot, even if you don't want to do it. And it would be so helpful for me if you could celebrate me sharing this with you, even if you don't want to do it because it's scary. And really, ultimately, what I want is just to have this experience of feeling safe and close enough to you that I can tell you anything and that you're not going to judge me for it.
Okay, time for a quick break. This podcast was made possible by Uberlube. It's a luxurious silicone lubricant that enhances sex and intimacy. We receive emails from listeners who have tried Uberlube, and the feedback is unanimous. We never knew lube could be this good. It's also less likely to throw off the pH than most other lubes, and there are thousands of doctors recommending Uberlube to their patients, whether they want to make their hot sex even hotter or for folks experiencing dryness.
Uberlube is without a doubt my favorite lube. It has no flavor, no scent, and feels absolutely amazing on my body. And it isn't just for sex. I use it to tame my hair frizzies, to prevent chafing, and I even put some in my mouth before an oral sex session. Totally ups my blowjob game. Oh, and the bottle, it's beautiful. It looks like a cosmetic product. So I just leave it out on my nightstand, totally shamelessly. To learn why we think it's the best lube on the planet, check out uberlube.com and use code SHAMELESSSEX for 10% off, plus free shipping. Again, that's uberlube.com and use code SHAMELESSSEX for 10% off and free shipping. This podcast is free to you because of another one of our amazing sponsors like Satisfyer. Looking for the perfect gift for your partner or even your friends this year? Well, look no further and give the gift of pleasure with Satisfyer's pleasure devices. Satisfyer makes beautiful vibrators and air pulse stimulators made with cutting-edge technology, and they're really affordable so you can spread that holiday cheer. And Satisfyer's new line of products are Bluetooth enabled and pairs with the Satisfyer Connect app so you can control the motor's speed, vibration length, and create custom sequences without ever pressing buttons. The app even lets you take control of your partner's device, allowing you to use the app to play with power dynamics. That's ho ho hot.
I like vibration, but I love the feeling of air pulse stimulation on my clitoris. And now I no longer have to choose between one sensation or the other, because with Satisfyer's dual love, you can have both packed into one beautiful pleasure device. Satisfyer really does make some of our favorite pleasure devices, so give the gift that will satisfy all the adults on your list this year, because Satisfyer is offering our lucky listeners 30% off any Satisfyer when you go to satisfyer.com and enter code SHAMELESS30 at checkout. Again, if you're looking for one of our favorite new devices, go to satisfyer.com and use code SHAMELESS30 for 30% off. All right, back to the interview.
I like that you're inviting people to not have to share the full picture, right? So like you said, using the rape fantasy again, if I feel shame about that or I want to freak a partner out, and I have freaked a partner or two out with that, by the way. And by the way, and this, we're going to get into this question a little later, the difference between kind of role play and fantasy. It's, for me personally, it's not something I actually want to do. It's my spank bank material. It's hot. It's what I like to watch in porn. I'm a fucking feminist, by the way, and I still, for some reason, get off to this since my 10-year-old brain saw Melrose Place, okay? So, and I have experienced that sharing with people where they were like, that's not normal. That's weird. But I'm actually like, I'm not asking you to do this, but I am into power play. I am into being sometimes a dirty little slut that needs to be punished. You know, like that's its own thing. But I have never had an experience where I've said, can we do this as an actual rape play thing? And that's just me. And some people might want to do that. So my question here is, what happens if there's a fantasy that I have that I want to do and explore, and I share that with my lover and they don't want to share that with me? Like, how do we navigate that?
Well, I think that there's a couple of options. Maybe they don't want to explore a rape fantasy with you, but maybe they would be open to exploring some other kind of power play with you, right? Or maybe what they would be open to doing is just hearing you talk about it, but maybe not participating. Or maybe what they might be open to doing is throwing in a little bit of dirty talk. Ooh, you really like it, don't you? You're going to take it, right? Just like little pieces that kind of give a nod to your fantasy without having them feel like they're going too far into the pool that is too deep for them. You could also see if there are tangential fantasies that might work for them. So maybe it might be he's forced to have sex with you. Somebody has a gun to his head. Mm. So he doesn't have that whole moral obligation of it. It's just like he has to do it. But, you know, so like, or it could be some kind of stranger experience where you're both drugged and you didn't realize what was happening. Or, you know, there's like ways of just maybe getting a little bit creative around how do we mitigate the emotional hiccup for the other person. So oftentimes with regards to at least a rape fantasy, the emotional hiccup is I don't want to play with those thoughts or those fears or those fantasies because I don't want to go there. So another piece to it too might be creating some sense of permission and safety for them, and doing some de-shamifying around the ways in which maybe they have had fantasies of being an aggressor or taking advantage of someone else that they have shame around. And so fantasizing it with you isn't about you being too kinky. It's about them worrying about them being too kinky. And so that might also be a part of it.
And I just want to add, as you say some of these things, so for listeners, some of this stuff could be super triggering, right? Like we might be, April's just talking about some step-parent stuff and I'm talking about some rape fantasies and there's some things you're talking about being drugged and all these things where some people might be listening. They're like, I'm fucking triggered right now. This is really scary for me. You're talking about something that actually happened to me. And I think that you might be having some thoughts about that too. And I'm just wondering maybe if also for you, Dr. Alison Ash, could offer our listeners some guidance, but you have something to say about that too, I think.
Because this is a trigger warning thing I just wanted to bring up because we, of course, anyone in the field of sexuality is all about consensual sex, and any sex that's consensual can be considered good sex. But when we go down the fantasy route, and especially if it's in someone's brain, you have a lot of avenues for the consent bridge not being able to be crossed because there could be animals. There could be a lot of things that necrophilia. There could be a lot. I'm just saying this is the thing is because we're not saying to go explore those. What I would like to know is, when someone is seeking these fantasies or they have these fantasies, what are they to do with these? Is it talking to a doctor? Because we don't want people to produce porn that has this behavior, because that's where this fucking bullshit starts going down a dark rabbit hole.
Like the non-consensual stuff.
So this is like with someone that does, which I'm not saying anything's wrong with them, but what's the best avenue to approach that? If someone's like, wow, these fantasies are, I know they're not consensual. What the fuck do I do with them? They're in there and I don't know what I can do.
It's good. So two-part question for our listeners who are triggered right now, please help them. And then April's question.
Okay. Great questions and great points. For those of you who are triggered out there, just take a couple of deep breaths. Your level of upset and activation makes a lot of sense. It's totally warranted. And I hope that we can put a trigger content warning on the podcast so that,
we will.
Okay, yeah. Great. So that you'll
no
know
worry,
in
we got
advance.
This in the intro. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that it's a big topic. If you're feeling activated right now, engage in something that's going to be soothing, something that's going to bring you a sense of regulation for your nervous system. So that might mean taking a walk, snuggling with your pet, taking a long shower or bath, listening to your favorite music, wrapping yourself up in a cozy blanket, whatever it is that's going to start to just bring some soothing to your senses. Maybe you need to call a friend, ask for a cuddle if one's available to you. Be gentle with yourself right now. I think that more broadly than that, when we're talking about the world of fantasies, it's absolutely necessary to also talk about shame, because I think that oftentimes fantasies and shame run parallel to each other. And shame is a fear of rejection, right? That whatever it is that I'm ashamed about or I'm being shamed for, that there's going to be a sense of rejection on the other end of that, which is physically excruciating. And so we want to hide the things that we feel ashamed about. Now, of course, the antidote to shame is acceptance and belonging, which can oftentimes be communicated with empathy and validation. And so I think something that's really important when we're thinking about exploring our fantasies is that we can really think about the ways in which we have all received shameful messages from maybe our family culture or religious upbringing or our peers, media, as well as just the ways in which we've internalized sexism and homophobia and all sorts of other kinds of really limiting shame-inducing belief systems. And so I think always working with a practitioner, whether that's a coach or a therapist, can be incredibly helpful, because that experience of moving through shame cannot be done on your own. Because we need that acceptance, that belonging, that empathy. And I would say, please find a coach or therapist that has that is sex positive. That if you have fantasies around non-monogamy or kink, that is informed around non-monogamy and kink. Not all therapists and coaches are. And so making sure that you're working with somebody that's going to be supportive and helping you unpack some of that shame. And then I think the last piece is realizing, you know, to throw back to what we talked about earlier, is that there's something empowering about getting to create it in just the right way, just for you, in a way that it's never going to happen in real life. And so the more that you can embrace the healing power of that, I think the more that it can help to reduce the shame. And then, of course, when shame gets reduced for you, both because you're doing your own work and hopefully maybe you're working with a practitioner, that will make it also easier then to share it with other people, because you have this templating of that going well.
That's the thing. That's just, I feel like we can, these things can get shrouded in a lot of negativity, and people will again judge, or, and they're ashamed to talk about those things and seeking out help. It's just, this is shameless sex. It's to improve your sex life, but there's also pieces that can be shrouded in darkness, and sex can be a dark place for people. And so
but also hot at the same time.
It can be super hot.
It's dark and hot.
So sometimes we can't look away though from the folks that a lot of times suffered trauma, and that's why they bring into fantasy things that occurred in their lives. And so the tool here, from what I'm understanding, is to seek someone to sort of help you move through those things so you don't end up doing something that could get you thrown in jail, or that you would absolutely not be commended for, let's say.
Well, and that's the part here when we're talking about, like, so there's fantasies and then there's role play, or there's fantasies and there's what I want to actually happen. So let's take it to something, I'm going to go with like a middle ground thing, so not like full necrophilia or things like that too, but like, let's go with golden showers. Why not? Let's talk about golden showers. So in my mind, I'm really turned on by golden showers. The idea of being peed on or peeing on someone's just really fucking hot. I've never done and by the way, this isn't true for me. I'm making up a
thing. You actually have done that.
I'm not the one with the fantasy. Someone else had the fantasy, and I did try it. And it wasn't really my jam, and I didn't shame them.
That's like every shower for me.
Yeah, I tried it. I tried it once. It was their thing. I was like, you know what? Yeah, I like that that's your fantasy, and we tried it, and it's not really my jam. I might be down to do it again, like one or two more times. It just doesn't really turn me on. It's like a little neutral. In fact, actually kind of turns me off a little bit, but that's me, and you get to be you. But my question here was more like the tricky pieces of, okay, when we have something that is the difference between fantasy, role play, and real life. When we have a fantasy and we are unsure, do I want this to be real life? And also, we're also speaking to some heavy stuff around sometimes we have fantasies that do want to be real life that are not consensual. Mm-hmm. And that's what April was saying, like, don't get thrown in jail for that shit. You know, go work with someone on this. But I guess this is a really complicated, convoluted question of just these different areas and how they can show up and how we can work with them within ourselves or others.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. So when we're fantasizing, it is in our minds. Sometimes we might be creating a fantasy together. It could involve some amount of dirty talk. That could be something that is a way of kind of still having a shared fantasy that's staying in the realm of fantasies. Role play is then when you start to enact it. I would say that whether or not you're sharing fantasies with a person or you're enacting a role play situation, that consent is absolutely necessary. So if you're going to share a fantasy, I'd love to share a fantasy with you. Are you open to hearing it? If you, at any point you want to stop hearing it, you can let me know in this way, right? Would you like then to role play or to create what a threesome could look like together? Okay, so then we're going to talk about who's doing what to whom and who the sexy third is, and we're creating the fantasy together. Now let's say that I want to role play it out. And so then I would then get consent to role play it out. Maybe that might mean using a sex toy as the stand-in for the third person. Or maybe it might mean my partner leaving the room and coming back in and using a different voice. And now I'm pretending that it's a different person. But again, getting consent for every step of the way. And then maybe at some point we might decide that we want to have a threesome in real life. And then that would involve getting consent with your partner and getting consent with a third person and talking about what things you do and don't want to have happen together. And so I think that, if you're unable to consent in the sharing of fantasies, in the creating of role play, or in the enactment of it in real life, then it should just stay in your fantasy mind. And then that's not something that is appropriate to bring somebody else involved in. They need to be able to consent.
I think you just nailed all of the questions that we asked. It can be a heavy topic, but it can also be a super hot topic. That's the thing. And I'm glad I felt comfortable enough with you to ask you that, because it's so important. There's so many people on this planet. We can't just always shine light on the fun fucking things. I would love to every day, but sometimes, stuff gets dark. And I think you're such a wonderful, not only doctor, but the way that you explore folks and are acceptant of what people's desires and fantasies and all of the work that you do, because you have a multitude of not only experience, but credentials and accredited hours of
Stanford.
Will you just tell people? Yes, please. Will you tell people, instead of me giving you clout, which I'll give you all the clout, I will introduce you, but talk to folks out there about your offerings. I know you have a course, I believe, coming out in January of 2022. How can people find you? How can they work with you and get more Dr. Alison Ash.
Oh, you are the sweetest. I am so grateful to get to be here and to collaborate with the two of you. It's such good cheerleaders. I'm just so grateful. Well, the best way to get a hold of me is to go to my website, which is TurnON.love. And there you can find out more about my coaching practice. I work with individuals and couples and groups on a huge variety of topics. And you can also get information on all of my pre-recorded content, as well as some of my live workshops. I have How to Eat Pussy Like a Champ upcoming, which I know
number one. That's our number one episode.
But I bet the actual class is even more exciting.
Yes. 3 hours on this topic. So yeah, you better believe you're going to leave well-versed. And it's great for both givers and receivers alike. So if you have a hard time receiving the kind of pussy pleasure that you want, check out the workshop as well.
I think I need to go to that.
You get a PhD in cunnilingus.
That's right. Okay. And then in January, I have a 2-month long course starting called Sexual and Emotional Intimacy Skills. This is also a class that I teach at Stanford University. And it's a wonderful, comprehensive class that will give you a wide variety of skills and help you learn how to practice and integrate them to help you be able to cultivate and sustain the kind of emotional and sexual intimacy that you are desiring. So the list of topics are really broad. You can go to my website, turnon.love, and find out more about it there. There's a banner right on the top of the page that can take you to more information about that.
And that's January 2022, right?
January 2022, that's correct.
And if you're listening in 2025, Allison always has offerings will probably forever be working with people.
She might be president of the United States.
Yeah, she might be president of the United States. So. And thank God for that.
Finally. Saving the world one orgasm at a time.
Hey, that's what I say. Oh, my God.
Yeah, well, I trademarked it, so both of you owe me money now. I'm just kidding.
Your royalties are in the mail.
Thank you. April's the ultimate capitalist.
I love it.
It takes
a whole community of people to really elevate these skills and to help create the kind of space where we can both learn them and celebrate each other for learning them. Because I think for so long, it's been shame inducing to even want to learn these things. And I think we need to kick that whole outdated way of thinking out the door and celebrate. I mean, I want on my dating profiles, a little badge that shows me that you're doing therapy or that you've taken sex education courses. Like, that is an instant elevator booster. Like, go out there, empower and educate yourself. Because really, it's the best way to make yourself more attractive.
I think Amy would need one about childhood wounding. Have you dealt with your childhood wounding?
Well, no, we have this joke. So when I was a single person,
that makes my pussy very wet.
If like within the first hour, they would say my therapist, they'd be like,
and Amy's like,
all right, I need to go change my panties. My childhood was so hard. Blah blah. I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, when you were dating, you're like, so I went out with this guy, and he immediately was like, so my childhood wounding. Yeah. I was like, did you sleep with him?
That's like way better than like, oh, you're so hot, you're so sexy. I was thinking, like, do you have a therapist though?
Yeah.
Or like, you don't have to have one now, but have you had one in the past and you're gonna have one soon? So come on.
Are you interested in going to therapy with me now? Even if we're not together, do you just want to go to therapy?
Oh my God.
All right.
You're the best, Allison. We love you so much.
Thank you. Yes. We'll see you again. You're coming back.
Oh, you'll be back.
That's right. You know it. I'm always back.
If it's consensual, of course. You're you're coming back.
No, you will come
back. You will be back.
I'll consent to non-consent for that.
Yeah, cool.
Okay, good. Well, I'm going to fantasize about drinking wine, which I don't have to fantasize too hard because it's right here. And I've been drinking it throughout this beautiful podcast. So if you have any wine fantasies, it's the holidays. And then after that, it's just another Wednesday or Thursday or Friday or Tuesday if you're listening to Shameless Sex. So go ahead, check out Martin's
Wine. It always
ends
with day.
It does.
If it ends
with day, then you can go ahead and check out marginswine.com. You can go ahead, just sign up for her newsletter. That's all we're asking. Then you get to know about her releases. And then if you want to buy some wine, you can save some money. Buy 3 or more bottles, use the code shamelesssex10. You save 10%. If you buy 6 or more bottles and you use the code shamelesssex15, you save 15%. Yeah. I'm quitting Shameless Sex. I'm going to be an auctioneer, y'all. That's right.
No, please don't leave us.
I'm going to do rapping.
We need you.
All right. We love you all. Thank you so much for listening. I'm going to give you one more invitation. This would just take you 5 seconds. Really, just go to iTunes, search for Shameless Sex. Even if you're subscribing to us, go and give us a review. You can write anything. You can write, somebody today just wrote, I jack off to this podcast, which is fine.
But they still
gave us 5 stars.
And so we're down.
And then he just put some, or they put some emojis. So you can do whatever you want. We love 5 stars. We read every single one. All this does is help people find these amazing doctors and experts that we have on our show, like Dr. Allison Ash.
Schnicky.
Schnicky in the house. So please do that, y'all. It will just take a moment of your time, and we appreciate you, and we read every single one. So until then, thank you for being part of the Shameless Sex Revolution. We'll see you next Tuesday. Ciao for now. Schnicky.
Schnicky.
Want to learn more? Go to shamelesssex.com.
And for 15% off of some of our favorite sex toys, use code SHAMELESSSEX at purepleasureshop.com.